Welcome to Modular Podcast, episode 5 on filters. We've got our normal me, Greg, and Matthew. Greg, how are you?
Hi, Ben, how are you?
Yeah, good. What have you been up to modular-wise?
I picked up in a Chemie's castle. Chemie's? What is it?
picked up in a Chemie's castle.
I've got Chemie's, I think. I don't know.
Whatever, I picked one up anyway. 4-Up FM. Really cool. Instant house machine. 90s house machine.
Nice. I've got my eye on one of those. They look great.
So is that you using the chord function a lot? Is that why it's the 90s house thing?
Well, I've been using it a lot today. Just before we came on today, I've been using it a lot for really nasty kind of basses. Sounds a little bit like old 16-bit era kind of bass lines, kind of Streets of Rage type stuff.
Yeah. It certainly does Mega Drive kind of sound, which is cool.
Yeah.
We'll come back and talk about it in a bit. Matthew, how are you?
Yeah, great, thanks.
Nice little, well, it's almost a glowing surge with the sun through the window.
I know, you're like, oh, the Holy Grail. Yeah, so I've been, when I have had a chance this week, which I've been busy, but I've just been going to the Surge at the moment. I mean, I've got a lot of the Euro Surge modules as well. But yeah, this is where my head's been at the moment. It's kind of infinite possibilities through restrictions is what I would sum up the Surge environment. That's what I like about that, is that there's a limited amount of modules, but the possibilities are endless.
Yeah, we'll come back to that as well. I'm interested in pairing of gear. You have a little hub. And we've got Tyler from WMD. How's it going?
Doing well, and yourself?
Yeah, good. You're going to be our man in the know as the only person that's the band. What have you been up to modular-wise? Busy at work? Managed to play on it?
Yeah. Modular-wise, it's like focus with like the Hertz Donut is like the favorite oscillator I tend to gravitate towards. Just make hardware techno. Been doing a few shows around town, but it's just kind of when I feel like playing out at the moment.
Yeah. Yeah. Not pushing it, trying to play every week or anything like that.
Yeah. No, I don't try too hard. No. I kind of bread and butter techno.
Yeah. Well, there's a video of you doing, which is not so bread and butter. I think the sounds are more interesting than just bread and butter. But there's a video of you playing on the WMD YouTube channel, I think.
Yeah, that one I was playing massively with the Synchrodyne, running that whole thing through the aperture. It was pretty fun.
I still don't think I get the Synchrodyne.
I don't think anybody does. I don't. I think that's the magic of that like module, because it's technically a filter, but it's also an oscillator. So it's like really confusing.
Yeah. There's one, and I can say it without being biased because it's not actually me in the video, but there's a video on my channel from an event where William came over and demoed the new, well, it was new at the time, the Steady State Fate collab line. Yeah. And he also did the Synchrodyne, and it was great, and I sort of started getting it on the night, and now it's gone again. It always super valid.
Yeah, it's kind of interesting how that whole module works. I kind of tend to call it an oscillator, but basically there's that sock or clocking a filter. And so, like, when you start doing lower cutoffs, it starts downsampling the whole thing and messing with the PLL, like those three knobs up there, the switches or whatever, the divisions and multiplications really mess with the whole thing, and tracking and damping. Like, it starts to fight itself, and you get this warbly craziness. I don't even know how to describe.
A lot of instability that's going on. Yeah, and finally, Corey, Red Stripe Down, how's it going?
I'm doing well, how are you, Ben?
Yeah, good. I think people would know you from, I think Greg posted it actually on Facebook, but you're generally number one on Instagram for modular stuff, like top trending.
I don't even know how that happened. it started innocently enough, yeah.
Just a constant stream of good stuff. I think that's all it is, you know, hard work.
I love what I do, and I just like to shirt, and I'm glad that people are into it. This is such an honor. I can't believe that all this stuff came through Instagram. It's amazing how that stupid little video sharing app has broadened my horizons, and I've met so many great people through it. It's been very cool.
Mm. That's crazy. Me and Matthew speak on the phone fairly regularly, and we're quite close in terms of about 45 minutes away from each other. But
the amount
that modular's opened up, I'm sure everyone has done other things beforehand, software, hardware, whatever that might be. But it's certainly been the thing that's sort of blown up the biggest, and also met the most cool people. The biggest impact on me, not in terms of made me the most money or had the most exposure or likes or whatever, but just generally met the biggest, coolest bunch of people, I think.
Yeah, I agree.
It's crazy.
It's kind of a wild city, man, but it's been fun.
Yeah, cool. There's a couple of little bits we'll just touch on before we get into the topic of filters. I'll go back to you, Matthew. What are you pairing with that Surge? You've got a couple of little pieces.
Over here, you mean this?
Garius.
Yeah, that's the Ibanez 8080 original delay pedal. It's like it was the first ever pedal, if I'm right, this I'm pretty sure, it's the first ever delay to be in a pedal format. It's just... I just basically call it my old machine. If you want anything to sound really old, it just sounds fantastic. It just puts it in a completely different space. And I think they go for quite a bit of money, these now. But I mean, it's just this shocking kind of David Lee Roth kind of pink, you know. The sound quality is amazing. It's just is instant oldness.
Reason I ask is I know you like sort of systems. You know, today I'm working on this, and this is the thing, the restriction. How's the Octatrack going with the Surge? We spoke about that last time.
Yeah, it's like a project I'm putting together where these will be the only machines used. You know, so for instance, for a live situation anyway, not that it's impossible, but it's quite difficult to say if you're doing a continuous live piece. If you want something that's other than just a drone, you need some other kind of backing material, as it were. So the idea is, because you can set up a through machine on the Octatrack, is I can live sample into the Octatrack, but then also process the audio that's coming from the Surge directly through the Octatrack and pass it back out as if it's like part of another instrument. So you can apply like sequenced ADSRs of incoming audio, so you can get lots of kind of, even though this isn't clocked to the Octatrack, you can get this kind of pseudo clocking effect happening. So for instance, you could pass a drone through it, but then apply an ADSR on the through machine and kind of break that up into a almost like sequence pattern, even though it's just a continuous drone. So I've been getting into using it in that way. So it's really kind of really nice and hands-on and creative, and you can just kind of jam out for hours and like wonder why it's gone dark outside, you know. I love doing that with it.
Yeah, cool.
Yeah, like you said, I'm very much into kind of like restrictions and very limitations of systems, so I'll just go, right, this is the only things that can be used. You like self-imposed restrictions, really.
Yeah. So you're going to end up with a sort of, like I said, it'd be pseudo-clocked. It'll be a sort of... Well, the Octatrack's obviously in time, but the content coming in isn't.
Yeah, so say, for instance, I may put a scattering of kind of pre-recorded sounds onto it, which will be sequenced. But the main idea is to process the audio that I'm kind of playing with live, like I say, in this ADSR kind of environment, so you can kind of open and close sections as it's coming through, as well as sequencing the actual effects, like the reverb and the, say, filtering. But yeah, again, it's meant to be just a sort of a minimal amount of filtering with that, really.
Yeah,
but yeah, we'll see how it goes. It's an experiment. It's a work in progress at the moment. I might get back to you and go, no, it didn't work. It was rubbish. But yeah, it's certainly something I'm kind of just had an idea for, and I thought, right, I'll see if this kind of project works.
Yeah. And you mentioned the Hertz Donut, Tyler. What's the... Is it digital still, the Hertz Donut?
Yeah,
I
just have the Mark 1. It's a digital FM oscillator. I just like how nasty it gets.
Yeah,
harsh noises.
So is it really stable FM?
Yeah, you can tell it to be stable or not. I always stick with stable, but there's also like stupid tracking, worse tracking, and like terrible tracking. There's like three modes, and then there's also just stable tracking. If you want it to sound like R2-D2, you use those other tracking modes, but otherwise, right, I just stick with full on tracking and just stays very nice and musical, and then you can start turning in the FM and get really harsh, like aggressive tones out of it. It's kind of a fun way to just make like one note techno.
Yeah.
I wind up doing.
Well, it's one of those, I think I prefer digital FM just because once the rest of the patch is set up with the analog stuff, as you take the FM depth high enough, the tuning drifts, and then by the time it's out of tune, I sort of lose a bit of motivation with it a lot of the time.
Yeah, that's another reason why it's great. The LI is another great one, the Laquila Guitaritas. I think you saw.
Superb.
That's another great one. It's got a lot more features than the Hearthstone, and it's a little bit smaller. I just haven't.
It's about my favorite oscillator at the moment. Is that I just think it's really brought something different to the party.
It's a really cool oscillator. Mastercraft did like a track on their new album that's just the LI and like the 909 kick.
Wow,
it's so good.
Nice. They've been by lately, haven't they? Did they come and jam on some modules at WMD?
Yeah, they did. It was pretty fun. Felt a lot like Alive 1997, like Daft Punk's album. They just ran a bunch of like drum machines through filters and just like enveloped them, like on, especially on the cymbals. Just sounded really cool.
Right.
But yeah, definitely listen to Alive 1997 if you haven't. That's what it felt like, and hopefully we'll have some video of it.
Yeah, cool.
Soon, so I don't know when that'll happen, but
yeah. But yeah. Cameras were on. That's the main thing.
Yeah.
Cool. And Corey, is there any specific modules for you before we get into filters? Anything sort of standing out at the minute, or that you're using a lot?
Well, you know, I just kind of dived into shelves. I picked this module up off of Muff Wiggler, did a little trade, and I got the expansion so I can have all the extra filters and stuff, and it's kind of an interesting thing, both in EQ. I believe you used that in one of your patches, correct? Didn't you, Ben? The shelves?
Yeah.
As EQ, or was that you, Tyler?
I think it was the ping patch, right?
Yeah, I used shelves with an offset into the queue, so you can get a sort of pinged sort of filter. Okay. Almost like an 808 clav sort of thing going on. We'll get on to that one later. So have you tried putting a saw wave in with standard Volt Per Octave and then putting the Volt Per Octave in the EQ?
No, I have not.
Super cool, because if you've just got, funnily, and this always happens, and I always break off to ruin the smoothness, we've ended up talking about filters just naturally. And there's loads of videos where I go, oh, cool, this has just happened, and then I tell everyone it's happened, and it's like the lamest thing ever because I broke off. But anyway, if you just put a saw wave in and like really heavily shape the saw wave with the EQ, as soon as you start sequencing the oscillator that the saw wave came from, it's just, you know, quite static EQ, nothing's happening. If you then put it the Vault Proactive in the frequency, because every frequency input is Vault Proactive on it,
right.
You get almost that's like a wave shaper.
Really?
As if it's part of the module, you know, shape the saw wave into some goofy looking waveform, and then it will track that wave with the sequence. Really cool.
Huh. I learn something every time from you.
That's, well, not the only reason, but that's definitely the reason that Wolves never moves for me. I love that just really odd nasal, quite harsh saw wave sort of thing you can do with it. Add loads of tops, scoop out some mids, find like one really odd peak in the mids somewhere, scoop the rest out, and then get it to track. And it's my favorite thing with that module.
Well, I will. I know that there's a lot more to explore with it.
Tracking filters in general is just like brilliant. Like if you want to just maintain that same timbre, but like change pitches, because as soon as you start changing pitch on your oscillator, but you don't move the filter with it, like everything either gets muffled a little bit or it gets louder if it dips below where it was. It makes it more stable, I guess.
It's kind of matching the frequency range of the oscillator moving up and down, you know.
Yeah,
rather, like you say, rather than missing some highs or missing the lows. So. Mm-hmm.
It's kind of it's one of those things that's built into loads of synths as well, and you don't know about it. A bit like when it comes up all the time, and I'm exactly the same. Got into modular, and I thought I just needed one VCA for my output, and I didn't realise that nearly every depth control was a VCA inside like a keyboard synth. But all the old Roland synths track, the filters track on those. Mm-hmm. Not all with control for it as well, if I remember right. I think the SH09 does it and there's no control over it.
Mm. Same with SH101.
Yeah, does the 101 have a slider for it, like a key track slider?
Oh, it does actually, yeah, it does. It does have a slider.
Yeah, the 09 does it.
The 106 did.
Yeah.
Yeah, the 106 did.
Yeah, I just sold my 106, so I know it did that for sure.
I had one too.
I used to have like Greg is. Greg sold a 106.
Yeah, ever since.
What made you sell it, Tyler?
I don't know. I wasn't using it a whole lot, and not a good keyboard player. Like, those are the main reasons. Wasn't using it enough. It's a great synth. Like, just sounded amazing, but just wasn't getting enough use for me.
That's fair enough.
106 chorus. I mean, it's what it's most well known for. Really want the Eurorack module. That's coming in.
Yeah, I saw that.
It's really. Yeah, I'm never. Obviously, not trying to be negative about it, but it's super deep, that 106 chorus, if I remember right.
Yeah.
I don't think it'll even fit in a duck. Yes.
Yeah,
really?
It definitely didn't fit in what I had. I tried to talk them into like making an SMD version so that way it didn't have to be, like, I don't know. The depth on that is ridiculous.
Did that Mode Machines make a pedal like based on a Juno chorus?
They did the filter, didn't they? Because they did a Wasp filter as well. They might have done the chorus as well.
I was sure that they did, or I'd seen some sort of mock-up of it, you know. Mm. Yeah, but like, I mean, I've got, you know, Juno 60 and the chorus is just amazing on that. Just that ability to, I don't know if they meant to do this, but the fact is that you've got chorus 1 and 2, and you can put both of them on at the same time, which it just goes mental then. You know, it doesn't sound like a chorus or anything, it just sounds like, it's just great.
It's hiss as well, isn't it? It's one of those that, the Casio CZ1, which is under my pile of rubbish here, it's the same thing. You turn, although that's on a slider, like a dry wet slider, you turn it up and you're literally just hearing shh.
Yeah.
It sounds great, but you know when you've left it on and you.
Well, when you put both buttons on, because I think you've got these choruses at different rates, you just get all this weirdness in the middle, and it's great if you're making some sort of like odd little percussion sounds on them.
Yeah. Does it get noisier, or just the LFO time in the choruses?
I've not really noticed it. No, it doesn't seem to get that much noisier. You know.
I mean,
This
Casio is one of those where you finish sort of jamming, if you've got a mixer or track sound in the DAW or whatever, you're like, where's that noise coming from? And you spend an hour troubleshooting all the cabling and patch bays, and then you just realise you've left the chorus on the keyboard.
Silence.
But it's one of those. And it's not super loud, but it's one of the, you can't see it touching the meters on the desk, so you really don't know where it's coming from. But it's part of it. I quite like the noise stuff. We'll get into filters. Most people will be aware of the four main filter types, but low pass filters, high pass, band pass, notches. Do anyone want to kick off with any ideas just for general how you like to use a low pass or high pass, band? I'll jump in with one. A lot of them are obvious. A low pass usually modulated by an envelope, but I really like using sample and hold on a resonant high pass before a distortion. So you get the sort of peaks coming up into the fundamental and just above. I saw one of my favourite ones for that. I'm nothing particularly that interesting to share with a low pass generally before we get into specifics, but creating phasers with band passes and notches. We'll get onto the specific patch, but does anyone make a high pass out of inverting a low pass and mixing it with a dry signal? Ever?
I haven't, not in particular. I've got quite a variety of filters, though, that are all sort of, you know, designated either band pass or high pass. So I'm not really, but that's a really good way of kind of rack real estate, as it were, being able to sort of do that.
Yeah. Well, the reason I ask, because the patch, there's going to be all the patch examples as usual. They'll be linked in the description for people, all on the same playlist and stuff. You can't get as far as I know, you can't get a Polyvox high pass. So if you want that character, you just take the low pass output, invert it, and mix that with a dry signal, and you get the high pass out.
I thought that was really interesting.
Yeah, it's a good technique, isn't it?
Yeah, it was really cool when I read your patch notes. It wasn't what I was expecting, and I thought the result from it was really nice, and it's something that I'd like to play around with too. Just these different. That's what's cool about this is getting to see all your little tips and tricks, and that was a neat trick.
Another cool trick I remember was when I was in Berlin, Vaclav of Bastel showed me. He had like two of the cinnamon filters, just listening to the low pass output, and one was being inverted, and summed them together, and you get that twin peak filter. It's pretty interesting. So like, no matter what, you're always getting like this, as long as one's away from the other, on frequency cutoff points, you'll get like this band pass out of it. And right. As soon as they pass over each other, they start doing the opposite. It's really interesting, and I tried to wrap my head around why that works, but it's a pretty crazy filter because as soon as one passes the other in the other direction, the other one becomes the high pass. Other one becomes the low pass. It's really a weird, combination that I would have never understood, tried or thought about as a creator.
Yeah, sometimes you just got to patch and hear it, haven't you? Something you can just look at the theory or read about it, but then once you've kind of done it, you go, oh yeah, all right, okay.
Yeah,
I'd love to find that.
Yeah, it's a pretty interesting one. You have to have two of the same filter, I think, or just two low passes. And then invert one and then mix them together and listen to that summed mix. And that's how you can get that really crazy twin peak filter kind of thing.
I'll try it with a Sara from DinSync, being a dual filter.
Okay.
Nice. Defibrillator as well, Ben.
Yeah, and I think when you match both frequencies on the cutoffs, it'll basically be dead. Is kind of what happens at the center part of whenever both of them are at the same spot. because the inverted is canceling out the other one.
Yeah, yeah, full phase cancellation. That's really cool. I have to try that.
Yeah,
that is cool.
The nice thing as well is if you don't use a Unity mixer and you actually mess with a level, the same making the high pass, if you play with a level of the dry signal and the inverted output, you get a certain amount of bleed that always comes through, which is kind of cool. And I guess that would work for that Twin Peak idea as well. If you deliberately made one sort of half the volume, you'd always get something happening. They wouldn't ever fully cancel out.
Yeah, Vaclav seems to be a pretty wealth of knowledge on filters. Like, at NAMM, we spent a good couple hours talking about him, and I learned a lot. So, a lot of different tricks I would have never thought of.
Ah, that's cool. I don't know what goes on in his head. That booth is crazy.
Yeah, it was.
It's
fantastic.
So crazy.
And he just sort of looked at me when he had the glass bottle swinging with a little sort of piston hitting it, and he just looked at me completely dead face and said, "It's got its own natural swing." And just
yeah,
we will have caught you. But he was really cool when we met him at Superboo.
I like those dudes.
But I only do the creating the high pass thing just because there isn't a Polyvox high pass, and I really like that Polyvox filter sound.
So that Polyvox one doesn't have the high pass?
No, I don't think any of them do. But neither does Ripples for Mutable Instruments doesn't have a high pass either, so I have done it with that before. And it's sort of a space saver, but at the same time, it's not really if you had a mixer and an inverter. You could probably save space over two filters, but it's just quite an interesting one to play with. It'd be really cool with something like the Dr. Octature? Is it the Intelligel and the Mankato from STG with a variable phase outputs. You can mix those phases and get some pretty weird stuff going on.
Yeah, the Mankato filter is nice. It's pretty cool.
Yeah, it sounds great. It's really nice and sort of standard use, just having 6 dB, 12, 18, and 24 dB roll-offs. But mixing them is quite cool because of the phase differences, so you do get these sort of weird, almost comb-like sounds when you mix in some of the outputs. I guess quite creative as well. Has anyone... I've talked about the Polyvox filter. Anyone sort of prefer any certain style of filter? Wasp, Polyvox, Diode, Ladder? What's anyone
having? Don't they? Like, different styles of filters. That's why most people have a lot of filters. They have banks of filters. I mean, they all have their own flavor and they all have their own uses.
I didn't realize how many filters I had until we did this project, and I started looking at my rack and was like, holy shit, I've got a filter for every VCA, and I just never even thought about it. But I love them, and they're all different. I couldn't choose one over the other. If I travel, it's about space. But other than that, I think they're all fantastic.
I think
that's what I do. I mean,
Rick.
Yeah, I was using like the MMG, you know, the make noise multimode gate. Again, from as well as it sounding, you know, it's a fantastic filter. It's quite a small size as well, and you know, again, really responds well to modulation. So yeah, that was a good concern I was putting in for live stuff. But then on the other end of the spectrum, I really like the Dofer A127, which is like a triple voltage controlled resonance filter, and it's huge. I forgot the HP of it, but it's three independent filters in there, and there's three LFOs for each filter. But I actually use it for making percussion-based sounds, so you can almost have like a pseudo kick, snare, hi-hat, effectively, and each... You've got, as well as a summed mix out, you've got an independent out for each filter as well. But it's also really good for creating kind of like formian vocals or vowel sounds as well. But it's a bandpass filter, but on the jumper on the back, you can either have them all as low pass or have just the first one as band pass.
But, oh, wow.
Yeah, it's a really versatile filter. It's one of them that's kind of not on a lot of people's radars, and it's an old filter, but it's really, really good.
Isn't there a breakout module for that as well?
Yeah, there is.
Feels like half a row.
Yeah, that kind of makes it even bigger. Yeah, if you didn't think it was big enough anyway, you can make it even bigger, you know. But yeah, I didn't really feel the need for that. I just really like the sound of it, though. It's really, like, super snappy. And like I said, perfect for things like making actual percussion sounds with it is just a breeze, you know. But yeah, also getting these strange, you know, sort of formian vowel sounds. Yeah, really good.
I think there comes a time with space, though. I mean, look at us all with us crack addiction behind us.
Yeah.
Where at least for home use, you sort of stop worrying about HP at some point.
Yeah, you do.
I've got a case I can't even see the right side of. I've got, you know, we've all got problems.
Yeah.
I like the idea of that stuff. There's the Phonotronic one as well, I think. Is it the triple resonator? Similar idea, I guess. Reband pass.
Like I said, these all pass through each other, or they can be out as individuals, you know. So again, that's another unusual take on just the standard filter, you know, the way that they can be passed through to each other, and you know, like using it as a percussion voice, effectively as well, you know.
Yeah, that's cool. Sort of odd uses for stuff. A little shout out for, I probably say his name wrong, but Eric Floor Reynolds, FLOHR, I think that's his YouTube channel as well. He mentioned using filters in the path of a modulator for FM or AM, which I thought was a really cool idea. I've not tried that. So if, I guess the general idea is if you were FM in a saw wave with another saw wave, pass the modulating saw wave through a filter, so you can affect the FM tone by filtering the modulator rather than just playing with it.
Oh, yeah, that's cool. Mm. Eric's a really nice guy. I met him in Atlanta a few months ago. He's a nice dude.
All right.
Yeah. Well, it's something I've never tried. One thing it did make me think of, and we had a quick chat, you know, quick back and forth about, AM modulating VCAs with wavetables is really cool. And I guess it's a similar idea that you set up this audio rate modulation, but then treat it like you would the general audio path. You filter it, modulate its level. I thought that was a really cool idea that, well, probably when we're done, we're going to try it out. Because, you know, most FM, or for me, if it's analog, it's usually sine waves on sines. It'd be nice to have something richer and play with a filter as well. Guess if the filter's resonant, I have to ask Eric if he's tried it. If it's a really resonant filter, you could probably get some sort of double peak going on if you made the filter self-oscillate. So you get the fundamental of whatever the modulating wave is.
All right, yeah.
400 hertz or whatever. But then you set the cutoff at 600 hertz and put a nice big resonant boost in it. You'd almost get like a double peak FM thing going, I guess. I don't know how you'd explain it, but that's a cool idea, I think. We'll get into some of the patch stuff. Quickly mentioned the creating a high pass Polyvox one, and also you mentioned shelves, Corey. The patch that I did for that one was just setting up an offset into the queue, and if you can make it, and you can do this with lots of filters, get the resonance just before it starts to oscillate and then send a voltage to the input rather than audio, and it just sort of pings almost like an 808 clav. Really basic.
Oh, that's cool.
And that was with shelves. Only reason for using shelves was the two middle EQ bands give you like a double peak, which is quite nice for percussion.
Sure.
I think that's what's happening in the... And we might get slated for this. It might be the only time we get a really negative comment. The Akai Rhythm Wolf that got heavily slated. But I think the percussion thing on that is the same idea, that it's two resonant peaks. It's quite cool for like toms, kicks, clavs, rim shots. Just having two sine waves, you can get quite a lot out of it.
Sure.
your patch as well, Grammy. People are going to have to check all this stuff out, but you made a patch that to me sounds like it's got two synth lines playing, but you said it's only one in the 303 patch.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah, it did sound like two.
Maybe that's what you're...
It did sound like two, yeah.
Well, I'll pull your patch up, Greg, and can you just sort of walk us through it? I mean, we've briefly discussed it, but it'd be good to know what's really going on. Fire away with the 303 patch. I'll pull a picture up.
Well, I focused on using the VCF 303. So what's happening in this patch, it's all being sequenced by BeatStep Pro. There's triggers coming out into the fire off the envelope. Getting up the patch. There's a trigger coming off the fire off the envelope of the VCF 303, as well as into the Turing machine there. I actually forgot to put the cable in there. It's clocking the Turing machine as well. So that's being clocked by it. It's all coming out into a VCA. The Turing machine is both out from a sequence out, and it's inverted sequence out. Is going through wavetables on the piston Honda, and the VCF 303 is coming out into both of those. Also, you've got a trigger coming out from the Turing machine into the accenting, and that's the kind of cutoff part that on the envelope in it. But I think the reason why you're probably thinking it's more than one synth line is because of those wavetables being modulated.
Right.
So is it a completely locked sequence, because it seems like you've got two of
sequence with semi-random wavetable modulation.
Right. So it's sort of 80% locked, or however, whatever you call it on the machine.
Yeah, I have a certain percentage of the Turing machine firing out random still.
All right, because it almost seems like two pitches as well, like a low line and a high 303 line.
No, it's just the octave shifted with the BeatStep Pro.
All right. That's quite cool. Because it definitely, and people will hear that in the audio, it definitely sounds like two synth lines to me. Well, we've got you describing patches. You've got the defibrillator. There's no distortion in that patch, is there, from what I can see?
Absolutely none. It's all from the...
It was crunchy.
Yeah, it sounds great.
It's cool.
I mean, you'll know, Ben, because you have one. You've heard what the defibrillator sounds like. It actually sounds like there's distortion on it. I don't know who it was, but it was described as an MS-20 filter through a Marshall cab, which is a pretty good description of what this thing sounds like.
I mean, I have an MS-20, and I mean, that's what's great about being able to distort with the peaks, the... you know, their version of the resonance, as it were. It just distorts so well, you know, sort of spiky way, you know. It's not kind of really a super abrasive, but it just makes this great sort of sound.
Well, I think the defibrillator is like an MS-20 multiplied by...
But more so, yeah.
Yeah.
It's absolutely on acid in there. It's crazy.
Mm. Yeah. And what I really like doing as well is that high pass. When you put that high pass and you have the resonance pretty high, you move down the cutoff, but you're still getting the resonant peak in the bass region, which means you get this massive wallop of bass. It's actually pretty insane. It's hard to control. Right. That's what's going to happen in a little bit in this patch. You see the Turing machine coming out to the attenuator. It's been full wave rectified, and that's coming out to the high pass. So what's happening is the high pass is that kind of movement where you hear where it starts to screech and the lower bass comes through. It's actually a sine wave coming through from the LAC LFO. So that coming through, and it's slightly modulating that, and that's the kind of movement where you hear in the bass kind of moving in and out on that part of it.
Even for non-distorted stuff, you mentioned a nice trick there with either a dual filter or two separate ones. Like I said, you boost, have a high pass with high resonance, and treat that like an EQ boost for the bottom end.
Because you're getting that resonant hump in the bass region, it's just really pushing your bass frequencies up really high.
And with that defib, it just kicks your teeth in when you feed it that sort of resonance.
So great. I mean, if anybody listens to this patch, it's it was hard for me to even keep it under control. At certain points, it gets away from me.
Yeah.
It nearly sounds like a Plague Bearer to me. That he's got that really aggressive. It's that mid crunch as well. It seems to almost sometimes lose a little bit of bottom end, and the mids are just so thick on it.
Yeah.
Do you use a Plague Bearer still? That's known as a bit of a crazy filter.
I do use the Plague Bearer. I use it for processing drums a lot. That's another one of my favourite. That's one of the craziest filters, if you want to call it a filter. In your,
I think the manufacturer's description says calling this a filter is a little bit.
You know, FSU, if you know what FSU stands for. It's called an FSU bottle module.
Yeah.
Well, I've got the Spectral Devastator, and I think that's in the same kind of league. You know, the Future Sound Systems module. But that's got, that's just like, it's a filter, but really it's almost more like a distortion pedal that's a filter, I think. And I really like using that for kind of almost like ambient drones, but just by teetering it on this kind of feedback area just adds this kind of almost like random textural sort of harmonics to a static sound, which is superb. I mean, it'll go crazy, you know, so easily, but just when you kind of rein it in and just listen to those kind of like harmonics happening, it sounds fantastic.
Yeah.
You know, kind of 1 millimeter either way of that is just, you know, crazy land, you know.
It's one of those. I had Finlay at Future Sound Systems that makes that filter fix my Frequensteiner from Livewire, and I didn't know it, but he said when the Spectral Devastator's got less input, so not as driven.
Yeah.
That's quite like a Frequensteiner. Have you had both to compare? Because I've not got both.
No, I haven't got both to compare. But yeah, I really like it for that. Like I say, it's easy. It'll do crazy all day long, but that's fine. But I really like using it for just like these kind of almost like narrow bandwidths of just textural effects. It's just, again, like I forgot who said it now, but like that's the reason why there's so many filters out there. We have so many of them. That you know you can go, right, I'm going to this guy, this is going to sort, this is going to really, I know what this is going to do to the sound, you know. So, it's a good one to check out if you want something like the defibrillator but don't have the rack space, or you want it for something live that's kind of a bit smaller. It's got that level of kind of crazy distortion.
Yeah. There's something with a defib, though, because I had... At one point, I had three of the Medic modules next to each other, and it fills that curved case, which is 114 HP, just for three modules.
Wow.
I could run a full gig off that much space, and you've just got three modules.
Yeah.
But the cranial saw, the oscillator, I mean, the sequencer's big. It's nice to play with because it's big, but that's just big. I accept that. But the defib, I don't know what it is, and I know you're the same, Greg. There's something about the defib that just makes it worth taking up half a roll with.
Yeah. It's come out of my rack a few times because I've gone, it's taken up too much space. It comes out for a couple of weeks and I just miss it so much that it has to go back in. it really does, the sound really does justify the space. I think you'll probably agree, Ben, it needs that VCA to feed onto. It's a kind of, I don't know what circuit it is, but it's a really dirty VCA.
Right.
Overdrives it all.
The one in the Manhattan Analog MA35, there, like MS-10 style filter, that's quite a... I think it's that were billed as a really basic single chip VCA that's quite noisy and not that great in terms of tech spec, as it were. But that added a lot to that filter. I think with a defib, every stage overdrives, doesn't it? Each of the two filters, the input in and the VCA will all drive. I think that's probably what it is. It's that three stages of, I'm going to say softer drive, but it rarely is. It's usually pretty bonkers.
Yeah. It's my only dual filter as well, so sometimes I just use two low passes for stereo filters.
Right.
Which is nice.
Have you noticed that the resonance is different on both sides, though?
Yeah, yeah. I noticed that, but I kind of like it, in a way.
Yeah.
I like a bit of stereo mismatch. If I'm going to bother with stereo, I want the two sides to be slightly different.
Yeah.
I'm quite happy that they're not exactly the same low-pass tone. What about your patch, Tyler? You ran, I think, definitely unlike most of us, you ran a full mix through a filter.
Yeah, I just ran the entire mix so that yellow cable coming from the output of the mixer is going directly to the aperture. And I didn't put a cable to show that I was just outputting directly from the aperture, but basically I just had like a few envelopes hooked up in there and to the switch matrix, and they were just or triggers that were going to the switch matrix, and then that was going to those two envelopes, which were controlling the frequency and width of the aperture. And then I just kind of messed around with the routings of different trigger sources going to the envelopes. And the whole mix was like the mutant bass drum, mutant clap, mutant snare, an LI that was being high passed by the Hadron Collider. And it was just kind of messing around with like filtering an entire mix through the aperture is like the main goal of that whole patch. Just kind of got inspired from what I saw Mastercraft do. So I kind of tried to repeat it myself in its own way, I guess. Does that make sense?
Yeah. I mean, it's a nice creative way of switching all the modulation. Literally just two modulation points over a full patch. But you've got, is it the numeric repetitor and the Zelaric repetitor from Noise Engineering?
Yeah.
And then having four different trigger rhythms to two different envelopes. Is that the sort of thing that you like set and forget? You sort of set that patch going and just sit back, or were you still playing with it a lot?
I was messing around with the filter cutoff on the aperture. I kind of set everything else except for messing with the routings of what trigger sources were going to those envelopes. And then I just kind of messed with like the CV amounts for both the frequency and width with the attenuverters, and then just kind of sweeped the frequency knob a bit. Sometimes got a little resonant. I think I cut out like all the really harsh parts that were like atrocious. There was some parts where I just like kind of messed with it, and the resonance can get really intense, and that's not really good on a whole mix, but it can be fun like one that's also VCA'd, you know, but I wasn't VCA'ing the aperture itself, so yeah.
I think we've all had that like ear bleeding resonant squeak at some point when you push it a bit too far and you dive for the master volume somewhere.
Right. Yeah.
It leads nicely onto, so what are people routing into filters in terms of modulation? Because obviously there, Tyler's got, you know, plenty of switching going on. Two modulation sources, but loads of different rhythms triggering stuff. Does anyone have any, like, people sort of see it as being stuck in a rut, but as some of them I find I really enjoy and I do all the time without feeling like I'm stuck in a rut. Like, I like to mix sample and hold and an envelope to a low pass. That's almost like a default first couple of wires I've been plugging in for the last few months.
Just to add that variation in there.
Yeah. So the envelope might only half open the filter, and then I'll attenuate, sample, and hold. But sort of importantly for me, keeping it, well, it could still be musical either way, but I like the, rather than a clock to the sample and hold, the gate rhythm of whatever's triggering the envelope.
Yeah.
So using ADSRs, if I've got a really long note, it doesn't hold the envelope, but I get, you know, several steps of sample and hold while it's a one long note. I just like, you know, the almost thing of just pressing a key at an odd rhythm and I get one random value per gate as opposed to all the 16th notes always randomly moving. Or
yeah.
That tends to be, if I'm not doing the sample and hold into the high pass, before the low pass. I'm not too keen on both for some reason. What about anyone else? Has anyone else got a sort of default or?
Well, I think you've touched on it. I mean, just, yeah, envelopes, obviously, you know, just because, you know, it's just so scalable what you can do with the actual sound when you put an envelope in there. That would be my kind of stop go-to one, if there is such a thing. That's probably what I find myself doing the most.
I find even though in sort of bread and butter patches, techno, house, basic stuff, the filter, as long as something else is in time, is quite forgiving about, you know, LFOs that are completely out of sync.
I like sync. I like that kind of phasing in and out, kind of over the bar line.
Totally.
I think it adds a lot of dynamic to a patch and gives it a nice variation without trying too hard.
Well, that's good. You've got other things providing the kind of rhythmic structure. If that's just kind of fading in and going out on its own, that can be just totally cool. It just doesn't matter. Yeah.
It's a nice...
I'm doing it right now.
Hey, William. You all right?
Guest appearance there.
It's not one of our pets walking in or partners or whatever. It's cool if it's a manufacturer in the background.
Right. Yeah, he's busy. We just got a new oven for the shop, so like to cook all the PCBs. It's insanely massive. I'll probably swing around and show you guys if you want. But
Let's check.
Sorry about the distraction there.
We'll spin it around and we'll check it out later. Yeah,
can you get really big pizza in there as well?
yeah, lots of pizza. It's a basic, really expensive, easy bake oven.
Yeah. Slightly off, well, mega off topic. Have you seen that picture of that guy cooking chicken on a heatsink? Well, not picture.
I have, yes, yeah. I thought it was spam, but it might be.
Right.
Crossing over different types of ovens. But yeah, the LFO and envelope thing, if you put the envelope that's been triggered steadily into the rate of an unsynced LFO, but very ever so slightly attenuated, that's quite cool. Because you get this meandering, you know, out of sync, slow thing happening, but just has these odd kinks in the wave, that's quite nice. Or inverting, if you take an envelope that's modulating the low pass, and invert that and put that into the FM of an LFO that's also affecting the cutoff. That's quite cool, because then per note you still get these sort of odd little ramps in LFO speed, but the speed never in time anyway. So that's quite cool. I should have done that. It's a patch example.
Don't know that, but I'll try that.
Yeah, isn't it? One of my standard things is just like running a second CV sequence to the volt per octave, like just trying to get syncopation going on. That's been like a pretty standard one, especially almost a year ago, like when I was on Vine doing a lot of stuff. That was like half of my patches had that going on.
Sort of creating its own, like I said, syncopation and almost accents.
Yeah.
They're in time, but not actually the volt per octave sequence in the patch.
Yeah, it's nothing special. It's like a typical thing, but that's like what I tend to gravitate towards, is like a trick, I guess, if you want to call it that. The whole using the volt per octave for the wrong purpose, I guess.
Yeah.
No, I like that. I like that idea.
There's another one I like doing, which is... it's really simple, but say, for instance, if you've got a mixer, take as many inputs as your mixer's got, say, for modulation sources. So there could be anything you want, envelopes, LFOs, etc. Put them into a mixer, take the sum out of that, and then put that into, like, if the filter cutoff or whatever, and then just play with the different levels of the mix of the combined amount of modulation, and you get some really nice kind of collisions at different points. You know, as you bring up and down each one of the separate modulation sources. Again, yeah, just all summed into one mixer and then straight into there. That's really good at just giving really, you know, certainly for evolving drone-based type patches. That's a really nice technique because it's not that startlingly obvious what's actually happening or where that's all coming from, you know.
Yeah. I like mixing envelopes for different shapes as well. Like if you were making a kick drum where you might want, say, an oscillating filter, because that's what we're talking about, and you want one envelope for pitch, maybe one that's controlling an amount into a drive or distortion and an amp envelope. And just mixing, you know, from really short to long, if you like, and mixing the free, because you can get a really exponential, like, mega drop in terms of having one really sharp at the start that boosts it way above, I don't know, let's say 10 volts. That drops, and then that hits the second mixer channel that might only ever get to 5 volts, and yeah, that's right. So you almost create an extra spike, an extra shape at the start of the envelope. That's quite nice. And as you start playing with them, as they overlap, you almost get like odd wave-folded tones if you sort of put the peak partway through another envelope. It almost sounds like you just wave-folded like the decay portion or the attack. That's quite cool. Although depending on the patch, I guess for you, Matthew, doing slower stuff, you'll always get away with it. But if it's that in-time techno stuff, you can create some slightly odd patterns, I think. But that might be people's thing. Super odd pattern.
Yeah.
What about you, Corey? Any, I mean, what do you gravitate to generally? The modulator?
Well, we've already talked a little bit about the Turing machine, and it's something I use all the time, and I use it in my patch example as well. I don't even have the expanders. I just use the basic thing to be able to create a new random looped sequence of CV, and I usually attenuate that with a channel and masks or something like that. But I find that it's such a nice way to modulate a filter, especially if you're doing percussion things, hi-hats, cymbals, things like that, or just white noise. I usually tend to gravitate to pretty basic and standard forms of modulation with my filters, and Turing machine is definitely my go-to for a lot of patches, or sending a CV out from a separate sequencer, and again, matching those, getting different pitches with different sets of CV going into the filter to create kind of dynamics, dampen high notes, but then also amplify them at random times. Being able to just twist that knob on the Turing machine or flip the switch and go from an 8, 16, 32, or I believe 64 step loop sequence is unbelievable and can create a whole bunch of new life in a patch with a flip of a switch.
Yeah. You can take it in a different direction, can't you? Just look by going flick.
Yeah, totally. It's a whole new line. New notes.
Parts of the sequence are being highlighted. And even though it's the same sequence and there might be some subtle undertones of what you were hearing before, it does give it new life and it makes you feel like you've gone in a different direction without actually doing much.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, it's a great performance tool because you can flip that fucker and just let it ride.
You just went super alien, Corey, in the audio stream.
Yeah, it was fantastic. There's some sample material there, I tell you.
Get it into the Phonogene. It did like a BBC radio.
Sound like a ring mod.
That was a sample of, I don't know if you guys watched Adventure Time, that cartoon. It's a little sample of Jake the dog, and it's been in my Phonogene for weeks, and I just can't get rid of it because it's so funny. I thought I had to put it in the patch somewhere, even if it's just kind of floating in the background there.
Well, let's pull up your patch and put some... we'll start to get through what you're doing. So I went with the idea of I'll make a few patch examples that show small things. Tyler did a full thing. Greg's done a couple of sort of nice rounded patches with drums in the back. I think you went a bit bonkers above and beyond the Call of Duty on this.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
It sounds great.
Sorry about this. I know it's kind of a cable mess. I just sat down one night and I felt like I should just start working on it, and then a few hours later, this is what happened. I hit record, and then that was it.
Yeah. Nothing to be sorry about. I mean that in a completely positive way. You went with the approach of, I'm going to show you every filter that I've got.
Yeah. Pretty much. The only thing that didn't make it in there were the Optimix and the LXD. But I started to run out of room and patience, so I just...
So what was... How did this patch build up? What's going on? Can you talk us through it?
Yeah, sure. I mentioned in the notes that I wanted to start with a sound source that is very definitive, something that has a very distinctive character, and I thought that the Mysteron was a great choice, because to me it always sounds like Les Claypool in space. It's just this harsh, low, nasty, and it sounds great, but it always kind of sounds like a Mysteron. So I thought it would be really cool to change it up a bit. I threw it into the MMG, which is probably my go-to filter for most things. I mentioned that I just like the way that it responds to modulation. It rarely gets out of control. It's, you know, the high-pass filter isn't as responsive as others, but it is nice being able to CV between the low-pass and the high-pass side of things. Just give it the patch a little bit more dimension, I guess. So it started with that, with the sequence coming from the Sequencer 1, which I noticed is in a lot of people's patches, and I absolutely love that sequencer. Somebody else? Sorry.
I just said I do all of my patch examples. Purely, I don't want to break you off too much, I'm interested in your patch, but purely just because you want a second or a third or a fourth CV sequence, you've got it. If you want an LFO, it's there. If you want random amplitude modulation on the LFOs, it's there. The CV input is great. If you set the quantizer, you can patch a random voltage out of one of the extra CVs back into itself. Super cool.
Yeah.
I love that thing.
Yeah, it's awesome. Yeah, it's with all the new firmware updates, it's just expanded. I mean, the clocked LFOs alone are just a godsend. They're so awesome. I use them for everything. I almost want a second one so I can use one just for LFOs.
I mean, I don't know for Greg and, well, Tyler and Matthew, all of you, if you've not seen the LFOs in it, I think there's about five different random modes. There's random step, random sine waves, random triangle waves. Any of the LFOs, random or not, can all have a random amplitude applied from 0 to 100%. So I get what you mean in terms of, I tie it up quite quickly. So two might make sense.
Yeah,
I think, never mind that it's his company and it's his module, but I think Chris Randall's got two, so we can all have two.
Yeah, right? It's just a very versatile tool, I find, and that's something I use for modulation and filters all the time also, are those clocked LFOs. And being able to move from sequence to sequence, you can chain these long sets of information, and being able to store the LFOs and call them back when you bring in different sections, it's so nice.
It does the sort of unsynced thing we mentioned as well, because if you've got a 16-step sequence but you set it to 15 steps long on the LFO, you get that out-of-sync cycle patterning, which is quite cool.
Yeah.
I like that, having the same LFO, you know, three triangle waves, but one's 5 steps, one's 11, and maybe one's in time at 4 steps, and it's an 8-step sequence. That's really cool. So with the Optimix in that patch, are you sort of, I don't have a, not an Optimix, sorry, the MMG, I don't have one, but I'm imagining you'd probably strike it for accents, move between low pass, high pass.
Yes, does it, sending a random step CV to the strike input, you get the occasional pop once it's hit a high voltage. It's a nice way to add a little bit of variation and some percussive effect to just a basic patch.
It does actually have a separate accent in anyway, as well as a strike, doesn't it?
It does. Yeah. Sometimes I find the accent can be a little sensitive. I don't use it as often as I use the strike, but it can be handy for some things.
Can you drive that filter? Because it's got an input level. Does it actually saturate a little bit and clip, or?
Yeah, it can. It's not as aggressive as other filters, but it, you can push it for a little extra dirt. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Cool. So is that sort of one voice, the Mistron and the MMG? Is that sort of part one?
The Mistron and the MMG are really the only thing supplying any pitched material in there, and that's just kind of the baseline moving around on a pretty simple sequence. The other stuff, the stuff that I describe as like waves of glitch or whatever, is just modulated filters going through other filters, going through VCAs. I love filtering filters. We've talked a little bit about that today. Mm-hmm. Creating a bass of a pitch with a high pass, and then being able to move up from there, or you know, invert that and I guess move down. Filtering filters through feedback chains. I just kind of wanted to just throw everything in here at once. So there's a lot of filters being, well, actually the micro VCA, the IntelliGel, is doing a little bit of FM modulation stuff. I've got some audio rates plugged into that. And it sounds really good in that capacity. That's one of my go-to filters for not only high pass, but for FM stuff. It's super small at 6 HP, very clean, and the high frequency response is awesome. I use it all the time.
Nice. I like that you've got a Mother 32 in there, and obviously Moog or Moog are known for the filter, and you're not using the filter. I'm nothing against the Moog filter at all, but I like that you're not filtering with the obvious thing on.
Yeah, with the obvious thing,
I've got the internal LFO is kind of filtering the noise a little bit, and then that's going into, I can't even tell what I did here.
It looks like it's going into the Tangle Quartet. Is it just a sort of modulated layer of noise in there?
It's just a layer of noise with just a little bit of modulation. I really like the way the noise sounds on the Mother 32. I mean, the whole thing sounds great, but I find myself using it just for the noise source more often than not.
Well, is it just a white noise, pink noise, or...?
I believe it's just a white noise, and I don't know, it just sounds good to me. I use it for snares and hi-hats all the time.
It's got the fattest white noise.
it does have fat white noise, and I love being able to blend that noise in with the oscillator as well through the VCA out. It's just a really nice, well-rounded little instrument.
Have you had, out of curiosity, have you had any other Moog synths to compare the filter to? Is it like a quite modern sound, or is it vintage? Yeah.
When I first started getting into synths, I had a little Fatty, and I honestly didn't like it very much. But at that point, I didn't know much about synthesis on its own, so that's not very fair. But that was so long ago, I couldn't tell you how that compared to this. I mean, I've played Voyagers, and obviously that's a dream. But in terms of other Moog gear I've owned, I don't know how to compare it, but this is a pretty solid piece of gear. I rely on this thing a lot more than I thought I would.
Right. That's cool. I only asked because Alan at AGH Synth, when we were talking about those two there, for anyone that's not seen, with a mini-mod voice, that someone was comparing it. I think someone else had bought one or a review online or something, and they were saying it doesn't sound like their Sub 37 or Sub Fatty. And he just said, well, it's not going to do, because none of the new Moog stuff sounds like a mini-Moog anyway. They're different. Yeah. Still got that character, but he said they're not the same thing. And I just wondered if you'd heard any sort of old versus new Moog gear to compare the two. Because for anyone, I don't have a mini Moog, but anyone wanting one, there is a comparison video on the AGH Synth site. And that thing, the transistor ladder filter, sounds identical. I think he said the only thing that he could do when he was trying to sort of test it in sort of lab style conditions, and I think he had four or five or six different mini Moogs to test, because obviously they're all slightly different. He said, if I just had a bit of noise in, because the power supply was shoddy 50 years ago, you wouldn't be able to tell the difference. No one would, was his sort of take on that. And that just nails that sound. But again, I don't have any new Moog stuff. I'd be interested in just to compare to see what they like. Most people are slightly filter junkies. Everyone likes a low pass sweep from a Moog, I think. So yeah, you mentioned audio rate modulation. That was one of my patches, and I managed. I don't really know why it was doing it, but I did the patch, the broken filter FM patch. Again, for anyone that's wondering what we're on about, all these are uploaded and links are in descriptions and things. But it's a fairly simple patch. It's just the saw wave from the Bird Kids VCO going into ripples from Mutable Instruments and then using tides, which was set to just be a triangle wave to audio rate modulate ripples.
It sounded really good with this, because I listened to this before I saw the patch diagram or read the notes, and I was expecting to see a hell of a lot more modules that are in the patch.
Yeah, me too.
I thought, wow, there's so much character and things going on in there. I was quite blown away when I saw that it was such a basic patch diagram.
Well, I think ripples, like probably like the UVC, VCF from IntelliGel, it's fairly clean. I think Ripples is quite Roland-like in character. Right. It can be kind of fat and juicy, but it's a sort of, not in a negative way, but it's probably the least characterful filter that I've got in at the minute, which can be a really good thing. Mm. But yeah, literally, and the only reason there's other modules in there is the sequencer one, just a pitch sequence partway through the video, and a little bit of sample and hold to the tides providing the audio rate modulation, just so you get some sort of step tonal changes. But I think bandpass as well, and it was Gertz from Erica Sims that first said it when I was playing with a Polyvox and doing audio rate stuff, and he said flick it into bandpass. And for some reason, audio rate for me on the bandpass just sounds amazing. I don't know if you sort of hear the effect seems more pronounced because you're not getting sort of a lot of low end that stays there.
Yeah. I think you're right. It does. It's almost like it's like you're tuning in with a microscope almost. You're getting a more obvious effect, don't you, really? Rather than just a broad brush of everything.
Yeah, it'd be the same if it was a high pass. You'd have a certain amount of high that would always stay there. There's sort of modulation happening underneath it. I really like that patch. If you do another nice one with you could sort of apply Tyler's trick of have the Vault Proactive go into the filter and the oscillator and use a different sequence to the audio rate modulator to create odd accents and syncopation.
Yeah.
You can get it very musical and just send the same Vault Proactive to everything. The modulation source, the oscillator and the filter. And get a sort of overtone from the audio rate that tracks and stays very stable and almost feels like a sample, because they're all tracking exactly the same, presuming they're calibrated right. So the same thing happens at different pitches, but I quite like not doing that. That's why I sent the sample and hold in. I like hearing overtones change while notes hold. That works quite well.
It's a cool effect.
Yeah. Thinking of bandpass, not meaning to ramble on about myself too much, but I went for it and did a few different examples. I did one with feedback path filtering, and that's something you mentioned as well, Corey. And I found a bandpass to be the most fun thing for that as well. I was doing it with a Sputnik delay for a while and using the humpback filter, which is like a hot-rodded SEM-style multimode. But since recently getting Aperture from Tyler, the man himself, that thing in a delay feedback path is, well, I can see that now being the thing that I do all the time. I've got a patch there. The more elaborate stuff not actually going on in the example bit, if that makes sense. The tonal changes, and the modulation of the dual oscillator from Sputnik is sort of where the more complicated parts are happening. I walked through the patch. It's a clock from the Variatic Arumption, which is a sort of dual burst pattern generator from Noise Engineering. And that's got a burst output and an end output, which fires a trigger on the very last note of the burst. So the burst is triggering a really short envelope, and the last output triggers a long one. So you're getting these odd sort of stutters that always end in a sort of long attack and decay. That's patched up into wave folding and AM modulation on the dual oscillator. Just sort of mixing those envelopes together before they go in. There's a little bit of sample and hold, which takes its clock from that end output. So every time I get a sort of gesture of sort of burst out of the variatic eruption, the last output triggers a new random value, which sets up a new random pattern in the burst for the next time it gets triggered. Which follows a sort of nice feedback system between the two. But then that's all going into a delay, all fairly basic, but because the Sputnik delay doesn't have an internal feedback path, you have to patch it. I find myself always rooting through something, usually a filter, but sometimes a bit of distortion, maybe even a bit of downsampling or bit crushing. And Aperture from Tyler at WMD, I've just found to be perfect because you can set up levels in the feedback that would blow your head off. But because you get the width control, you've so much on there that you let you sculpt that feedback path with the level on the filter, the dry wet on the filter, which are two things you don't always see. Feedback path on the filter as well, so you can sort of make the filter be feeding back into itself. And then having separate resonant peaks on the high and the low pass and a width control, it just seems the nicest thing, an easiest thing to get where you want to be. So in the audio, I was just trying to sort of sweep different bands up and down. So you got sort of high trailing frequencies or low. I think there's a point that it almost does overload and kick out a little bit too much feedback, but just sweeping around that spectrum of delay. It's really easy to control. You mentioned it with this Spectral Devastator, Matthew, about having things just on the edge.
Yeah.
Too far. And I find it's really easy to get that, almost like sweet spot tuning with the Aperture. Just because you've got all that stuff, input level, dry wet, internal feedback, you can really sort of just get it on the edge of... It's, because sometimes with a delay, I can't always get a sort of infinite feedback that doesn't actually get louder.
Yeah.
It's one of those reach for the master volume control things, I think, where you set it and you get in this nice trail and then it just comes up and up and up and up and eventually blows your head off.
Yeah, exactly.
I found it really easy to control with the Aperture. And I've had a jam with it since, just sort of kick your teeth in techno bass stuff. God, it sounds good. Tyler, you've done a good job.
I gotta check this out next week.
I don't want to suck up too much or blow my own trumpet for the patch that I had set up. But I've filmed it. The video will be up, if not by the time this is, not long after. And it just it does everything that I'd want it to do, and a lot of what we've spoke about. I think I've got an unsynced LFO going into the width control, so it gives you, and with the LED feedback on top as well, giving you these, if you can see the frequency range, the sort
of that's really neat. Again, when we talk about, you know, the fact of, you know, bringing something different to the filter market, it's got to be tricky, and just something as simple as that, you know, is such a good idea.
Yeah, so those 8 red LEDs show you which bit of the frequency spectrum you're in.
Yeah.
And you can see this unsynced LFO just taking, you know, I might just have 2 of those LEDs active and you just see it spike out every now and then with this LFO pushing it out. There's stepped modulation going into the frequency. There's an envelope going into the low pass. I've not really found all it, I can't do with it. And the two different feedback paths work really well. You've got one that you can talk us through it properly, Tyler, but one that the resonance increases a lot, as you'd expect, and then I think the other one's inverted. So it just seems to get...
It's just the feedback either runs through an inverting op-amp or doesn't, so the signal's either inverted or not. And
yeah.
One of them, like, it, like the high pass really affects the way the feedback sounds. And the other one, like, it just adds to it, like the high pass adds to it. But the other one, like, as you crank the high pass resonance up, it actually tames the feedback, which is kind of interesting. So there's like some stuff that we didn't really know what to expect when we implemented feedback, because its base resonance is feedback, so we weren't sure what would happen by adding just overall feedback to the whole thing. But right. I'm pretty happy with how it came out.
Yeah, I mean, it makes sense. If you've got a resonant peak and you invert it, you know, plus 10 dB of resonance and minus 10 dB of resonance is going to knock it back down.
Yeah.
So,
and the high pass is the first part of the signal that the whole filter, like the input, runs through, because it's four state variable filters in series. So you have like two high passes, and then those run into two low passes, basically, is how you get the aperture to work. And then it's just controlling the width and sweeping all four filters in one direction or opposite directions is the whole goal with the two knobs. And then, yeah, I guess it kind of makes sense why the high pass resonance is affecting the feedback on the on mode. I'm kind of thinking through this myself right now.
So why, you said it's four filters, why is it four and not two?
Is that silly? So we wanted to make a four pull on both sides of the filter, so it's two state variable filters to make a four pull low pass or four pull high pass, and then two more to make a four pull low pass. So that's to make a four pull filter.
All right, so it's like
two. You just put a two pull filter after another two pull filter.
Right.
So
okay.
We have eight pulls happening overall, which is kind of interesting. So. Yeah, it's four state variable filters to make that thing happen. We could have done it in two pull on each side, but we wanted to make it four pull.
Yeah. I didn't know that. I know you could do it in theory if you had two 12 dB cutoffs or two 2-pull filters. You could just run them in series for a harder cutoff,
yeah.
But
yeah.
I didn't realize that that's how most of the design...
How we did it.
Right.
Yeah.
So what... it's a good time to sort of ask you about the aperture. Matthew mentioned a few minutes back, you know, how do you bring something new to the filter market? And I think you have done. I mean, it's your first module in terms of your design and work at WMD. What led you to it? Was there something you were looking for that you didn't feel was covered already? Or was it just playing around and you stumbled on it? Or...
It was kind of just an idea that just kind of happened. I was just shooting a conversation with Bill about like making a bandpass filter doing exactly what it does now. And he said, do it. And he said, like, do it before I do it myself. So I started asking him questions, and he gave me the basic building blocks of like where to start on designing it, and then I would come and show him the schematic I made, and he'd tell me what I needed to fix or what I didn't need to fix, like, just there for moral support. And then, like, once we had the schematic done, then we started doing the prototyping of it, which then he did most of the basing work on it to make it sound the way it does, because like there's all those like tiny resistor changes and cap value changes to like really make the character the way it is. And that's stuff that I'm definitely not too knowledgeable in yet, because I don't have the experience like he does. So it was kind of a collaboration on that part. And I don't know. There's still a lot that I don't totally, like, I don't claim credit for, because I'm still very new to this whole thing. And it's cool to hear people say that I've done a good job. I'm glad that people like it. It's
I think the idea why it works so well is when I was when I was playing with it and I could do a standard low pass or a standard high pass still, mm-hmm. was a sort of real moment of, right, this really does seem to do everything. So if you just close, yeah. if you just close the width down fully, turn the frequency right down, but then just modulate the low pass, you just get the standard top end open and closes.
Yeah.
I did think before I got it that it wouldn't. I don't know why I thought that, because I'd seen the pictures, but I'd not sort of imagined that in my mind. I was always still thinking, right, it's just a band pass.
I mean, in the end of the story, like, it is just a band pass, but, like, Bill did a lot of work on making it where those ranges do work, where you can use it as just a high pass and just a low pass. And having those two CVs just to control the cutoffs of the high pass and low pass also help make it doable if you wanted to do that without the knobs.
Yeah. Well, I think it facilitates nearly all of what we spoke about. You know, random modulation into the high pass with a bit of resonance, or get the frequency set so the high pass has got a real nice notch in the low end, giving the bass a good kick, and then modulating the low pass separately. He seems to sort of offer a lot. You don't see, one thing you don't see a lot is dry wet on a lot of filters.
That was just like an idea we threw around just to see if it would be cool. And because it can get so harsh, because it can get pretty nuts, the dry wet is a nice way to tame it where you can still maintain the fundamental by mixing it back in a little bit. That's what I like about that part of the design.
It's a really, seemingly just dead simple idea, but really, really effective, just having that.
Yeah, it's been very useful. There's a lot of ideas that were in there that we didn't really know what to expect until we had the prototype, and we just kind of either stuck with them or dumped them if they weren't worth anything. So what you see is the end product there of just messing around with the idea.
Having a VCA on the input level is great as well. Does anybody do that generally? That was one thing I wanted to ask, that I guess that we all go in phases with our patching. I used to do quite a lot, and I haven't maybe for a year now, setting the input level on the filter where it will clip and saturate and you get a bit more fuller tone out of it. Then using a VCA beforehand and maybe sequencing a heavily attenuated input level so you get moments of saturation and not on other things. Does anybody do that, or is it not something that really comes up?
Yeah, I've done VCAs with the Spectral Devastator are almost a necessity, I think.
Right. Same idea, though. You occasionally want something to just push up and rein back. And
yeah, exactly.
Cool.
I don't know how many filters have VCAs on them. I can't think of any on the top of my head, but that's not for any specific reason.
There's probably
I like that we added the ability to overdrive your input a little bit too.
Yeah.
12 o'clock is like your unity, and then after that you get like, I forget how many dB a gain if you want it, but it's kind of nice to be able to overdrive things.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. I don't think I pulled it up at the time. I'll just, for anyone still scratching their head about the ping thing, I'll just pull the one up for that, and then we've gone through our patch examples. We were talking about the pinging filters, and I know you do this a lot as well, Matthew, to create your drums, setting filters. There I'm using shelves, and you can see I'm using a beef talk board, which is an octave switcher, but it just gives 1 or 2 volt offsets if you don't have an input. And just adding a voltage, you can just get the EQ bands, or it could be a filter, just to almost oscillate, and then just put a voltage. Is that most of your drums, did you say, were you using? Do you use that sort of thing for creating drums, or?
Me, I do like with the A127, with that having external inputs for each one of the filters on it, that's what I normally do. I would drive something in there just to ping that on, get the resonance just on that peak level, and then just using that, you know, then dialing the frequency for whatever kind of sort of timbre of percussion based sound you want to get. Yeah, very similar technique.
I really like, and again, I'll pull it up because it's on the screen. Rather than pinging it with a gate or trigger, which is sort of standard pinging a filter, using a sample and hold instead, and you almost get like a random velocity.
Yeah.
You can hear the sort of amount of ring in the filter change as the input voltage does, which I think works really well. One thing I didn't do, but works well, if you then patch the output back into itself for some feedback, you can start to sort of clip the resonant circuit and get a few more overtones and get a little bit more crunch out of it. That works really well.
Right.
So when you're... One thing I tried, again, there's lots of things we've talked about that we don't have examples of everything. Have you tried audio rate modulation, sort of combining the two ideas, when pinging the filters? So if you audio rate modulate the cutoff when it's just on the edge of oscillating and then ping it, that's quite a nice way of getting extra overtones.
All right, yeah, you would, wouldn't you?
Because a ping's usually such a pure little sine wave click.
Yeah, it is.
You don't get much from it. One thing we've not mentioned about is low-pass gates, really. Do people like using those as filters, or do you think of them as more as VCAs?
Both.
Definition, like that's exactly what they are.
They are both, but I meant in terms of how you approach it, almost. They're sort of like VCAs to me.
I tend to use them more as VCAs as opposed to, but just personally. I don't mean I never use them as filter, but if I'm going to, I'm going for that for that plucked sound, as it were.
So just get that vac filter ring.
Yeah, that's what I like about them, you know. And just because I've got a fair amount of other filters, so I don't tend to, you know, I've got things that in my mind do a better job at filtering.
Yeah, I use it for plucked stuff.
Yeah.
For a while, I was just using my filters, like, regardless of if they were low-pass gates, as low-pass gates.
Yeah.
Like, I just didn't have VCAs for a while and would just only use envelopes. And I would just have, I wouldn't even have VCAs on the actual output of anything. I would just run it through a mixer and close all my filters off. I don't know
if that's
relevant to the topic.
Well, yeah. I mean, I used to do it with the... Go on, sorry.
I was going to say, I used to break a lot of the, like, standard rules of, like, always needing VCAs by just not using them.
Well, this is what's good. When you can't afford or don't have other things, it's like, how can you get the job done? Well, it forces you to be creative. It makes you make different choices, doesn't it? Rather than just having a blank checkbook and go, all right, I need a bazillion VCAs now. You know, right. It's just doing things like that. I think those are the most exciting times in modular, you know.
Yeah.
I used to do it a lot with the Borg 2 filter, and I didn't have VCAs either when I started. I just had the AFG and the Borg and a quad envelope and a MIDI module, so I was just triggering envelopes. And as long as the filter shut off, I always thought it was fine.
Yeah.
And still do. It's, you know, as long as it cuts the sound off. So what?
Right.
Yeah, exactly.
It does its job. Cool. One thing I wanted to ask you, Tyler, I noted it down. You tend to put the Happy Nerding Super Sorter after a filter, I've noticed, in a few bits of your stuff.
Yeah, I use it a lot with the Zoxhart. Especially, that's like my favorite one to run it through. So that's already a filtered voice, but it's just kind of like my go-to distortion.
Right.
I don't know why, but I just kind of ran into it one day after patching it with my Zox Heart, and it's just become like a staple for me on like acid tracks and stuff.
It's sort of an odd one, because for those that don't know the Super Sorter, the idea is that it'll take a saw wave or triangle or sine and create that sort of unison saw wave thing, super saws essentially. But you're doing it on something that's already having filter modulation for
it. So it's not expecting a filtered wave, it's just expecting like a straight up saw wave and being able to copy it and spread them to make it sound like a super saw, you know. But when you send it like a filtered sound, it freaks out a bit, and you have to just, it like starts to just become a distortion. I don't even know how or why it works that way, but it's become like a go-to, like where I just test anything like new that I get, and just try to run it through a filter and then through the super saw, because it sounds crazy to me. I like that. Like, I don't know, it just sounds so crunchy.
I don't know if the modules are looking for like a zero crossing. I guess it wouldn't. The pitch is still the same. So I was going to say like a zero crossing point, and as the wave changes, that changes.
I don't think it's a digital module, but it might be.
It's analog.
Yeah, I think it might just be analog, and it's just, it does something to like copy the waveform and do like some sort of phase offset for like multiple copies, but I couldn't tell you how that thing works because I don't know what it actually does. I just know it sounds really cool. It sounds good for super saws if you like cheesy trance like pads, which are sometimes entertaining, but not my bag.
Well, a lot of sort of like the sort of Reese drum and bass thing is all saws in the drive. Really. It's definitely all analog. Spoke to Igor about it, and he's a big trance fan from Happy Nerding. And he wanted, I think someone challenged him, or he set the challenge to create an analog super saw as opposed to a digital one.
Gotcha. Yeah, and I love that module. Like, it's such a weird, like, I don't know how that thing works.
I bring it up just as another example of feeding things already filtered audio that aren't expecting it, which was like Eric Reynolds' idea of having a filter in your modulator's path for FM or AM. I guess ring mod as well. If you put a sine wave in and then a saw wave in, but filter the saw, you can have two clean sines, or as long as the filter's tracking, I guess, richer, more dirty ring mod going on. I think we've lost Corey.
Yeah.
He's I'll quickly invite him back in, and we'll see if we can just get him in for the end to say bye and things. If not, we bye, Corey. We'll see you next time. Has anyone got anything else to share? I think there's a lot of stuff in there for people. I know filters are a widely explored topic for a lot of people, but there's certainly a few things I want to go try from what we've talked about.
Yeah, I mean, it's like with all the filters that we do have, I mean, obviously we've only brought the ones to the front that we kind of, that, you know, that we're really using at the moment, but we've probably got other ones there for like what Greg says, you know, for there's a reason why there's so many, because they do different things. But yeah, this could easily be a 2-3 part kind of episode if you want to really go through different ones, you know, and just, it's just that character, isn't it? But I think I've said this on other sort of shows before, that I think a lot of people, when they first start getting into modular, they go kind of filter crazy and just suddenly just think that they have to keep buying. All right.
I don't know what the hell happened.
It's all right, you're back. You didn't miss too much. sorry, Matthew, go on. You're talking about people having...
I was just saying that, you know, when people get into modular, that's one of the things that they tend to kind of go and buy the first, is a few different sorts of filter. And it's not always necessary, I don't think, you know. Grow your system in different ways, you know, get other utility modules and other stuff, you know. You know, you can get by with one filter for a long time, you know. And it's not only then you get to know a few other stuff and then, you know, go and explore some more filters.
I think it's just an easy one, isn't it? In that,
yeah, if you buy, you get an immediate sound change with,
yeah, filters. I think that's how people validate having those huge A-frame keyboard stands. You know, you've a couple of different Rolands, a couple of Moogs, and they all have slightly different filter topologies. They all sound slightly different. It's a very instant way to get a different thing out of the same patch, essentially. But I think, like I said, playing with modulation, input drive, feedback paths, you can explore a lot more that way, as opposed to just one. We've lost Corey again. I really like, and I don't know why, I guess it's like your idea of jamming Matthew on a mixer for different modulation. I really like mixers, filters that have got mixers built in, like the AGA. The state variable from Manhattan Analog. I like having a small area I can do cut off, or I can do levels. You know, I like the idea of being able to modulate any of those things and grab them and just move it all together. Yeah.
Drive it, just adds that extra level of movement, doesn't it?
Yeah. I think having a mixer, not just for filter modulation, as that's a topic, but a mixer for modulation is really key.
Yeah, me too.
For most things. Like I said, some things unsynced, some things synced, a couple of envelopes, LFOs, some random. I think having a slew as well, if you've a slew that's got a fairly long slew time, I feel like you can sort of crowbar anything in and it's going to work, because you can always smooth out any odd out of sync chip and just make it work, you know. Singing the praises of utilities, I think, as much as. I mean, on that note, do we all feel like we've got over our filter binges, or has anyone still got a weird filter addiction?
Well, I think I need an aperture now. I think I'm.
Well, yeah, that's the take on from this. Yeah, just when I thought I'd, you know, if you'd asked me this before, I think, yeah, you know, I think I'm pretty much covered. And it's like, shit, no, I'm not.
It's the. Well, that's, it's
just.
Try again, Corey, we've lost you.
Jeez, I was just going to say, it really being part of the instrument the filter is, and how much I take it for granted of the modular thing, and it was a really cool project to sit there. That was pretty fun.
I'll try and sum up what I think you said, because we're losing you a lot, Corey, but just generally saying that the filter really is the character of the instrument.
I think we lost Tyler as well now.
I think we
may have to wrap it up, I think, here. I think we've got some bandwidth issues.
We're about to go into an additive versus subtractive argument.
I think so.
We were genuinely winding down. I was going to sort of say, as we lost Corey the first time, is there sort of any last thing anyone wants to bring up? Anything we don't feel like we've covered? I feel like the examples, we've got, is it 8 examples now for people to check out?
Loads of different ways there of looking at the filters from those. It's not just a sound through a filter, is it? You know?
No.
The modulation in there.
Yeah.
We could probably double that easily, you know, in things we've talked about.
It's quite an instrument in itself, really.
Yeah, exactly.
One thing we've not touched on, or it's been mentioned on its own, but not in the basic form, for clean sine waves, do people use resonating filters, or are you not too fussed about sines being that clean?
Why would you? Why? What is the thing with clean sine waves? I've never understood it.
No, I haven't.
Everything will filter into it. You could get a saw wave or a square and filter it to clean sine.
Yeah, when I hear these comments, you know, like on MUFs, when people go, oh, well, I've got it on a scope and it's not exactly a pure sine wave. It's like, well, you know, are you working in a lab? You know, you're a musician.
Yeah, aren't you? It's a little like,
we got a glimpse of that as it glitched. Yeah, I'm not too fussed. I mean, it's an easy way to get a tone. It's an easy way to get a tone, I think.
Yeah.
I was just singing the praises of the Bird Kids oscillator to Michael at Bird Kids, in that I don't think any of the waves are perfect on that, but I think they've really listened and they've made, like, the sine wave's got a bit of meat to it, and obviously a pure sine wave shouldn't have any weight to it. But it sounds great. It sounds so.
At the end of the day, you're not making a piece of lab equipment.
No.
You're making an instrument. You know, so, you know, there's a time to stop looking at a scope and listen to your own sort of ears and go, does this actually sound good, rather than trying to make it completely accurate, you know. I mean, there's a case for making it accurate, but, you know, you've got to keep stopping and just going, does this sound good, you know.
Yeah. I got asked how Oberheim, like, the God's Box humpback was, because it's an SEM filter. Yeah. I don't have any Oberheim stuff to compare, but all I can say is it sounds ace, and I don't really care. It's same with the Polyvox from America, and I guess the Wasp as well. They're inaccurate, they're noisy, they're gritty, they're full of character, they snarl, the resonance is a bit weird. You can hear it in that high-pass example where I made the high-pass inverting the low-pass with a dry. The resonance almost bubbles and gargles, and there's no modulation on that filter in the example at all. It's just me sweeping the cut off, turning the resonance down. I don't think I'm over, to go back to what I was saying, I don't think I'm over the filter binge. I think I've just hit peak filter enlightenment. I've got to.
You attained filter enlightenment,
Not in any egotistical way, I just feel like I have enough coverage of Moog-style stuff. Although the aperture's kicking it all into touch. Honestly, I'm really impressed. Yeah, go buy one. I'm so good. But, you know, I think it depends on what you're doing entirely. You know, you could perform with one filter in a rig and never change it. I like having three or four different colours, though. Especially you mentioned the Hadron Collider, Tal, just for one last question for you. Is that a bit bonkers as well, like the Synchrodyne, or is that, it's not tame, is it?
It's a pretty crazy filter. The resonance can almost sound like a really mad turkey, like it like garbles, like it has this gargle to it. I don't know, you have to listen to it, like, to know what I'm talking about, but... I really like that filter. It's basically another dual four-pole. Like, the aperture is a dual four-pole filter. It's just locked in a certain way that, like, if you wanted to do the same thing with any other dual four-pole, you'd have to hold two knobs to do the width thing on it, set, like, one side to high pass and the other side to low pass, and then move the frequencies to set your width, and then to, like, sweep them both directions. Which, like, is not really feasible, like, in a performance, and it's kind of a pain to set up as a patch. So that's kind of where the aperture, like, makes that a little bit simpler. But, like, in the end, if you wanted to, you can use any dual four-pole and kind of get close to it. There's also different design choices made in the aperture that'll make it different than what you can try to recreate. But it's a... The goal is to make it more of a bandpass than anything on that one. But the Hadron Collider is a really cool aggressive filter as well. Has a totally different character. It's also a state variable filter, based filter.
Cool.
So,
yeah, cool.
I don't know if that helps.
It's just an interesting... I like the idea that the Synchrodyne's nuts and barely anyone knows what it does. Aperture's really good, and just as you'd mentioned, the Hadron Collider, I thought that was bonkers as well. There's an underlying current of craziness going on, which is cool.
Anyone who's played with it would know, like, that resonance thing I'm talking about. I don't have one, like, in front of me to, like, make that noise, but it's really wild.
The Polyvox one does. That's what I meant in the patch example that'll be uploaded, that you can just leave it static, hands off, not touch anything, and it just, yeah, it like gobbles and gargles, and it's almost burping and bubbling away, and I think the wasp filter does the same thing. Yeah. I don't know if it's some sort of unstable feedback design in the resonance or how they're doing it, but you can leave it and it sounds weird and alive and a bit strange.
Yeah.
But it's really cool. So, yeah. Cool. Well, thanks everyone for patch examples. People might have been pausing the video and checking those out as we go in. If you haven't, they'll all be linked in the description. Check out the Aperture from Tyler. I think we mentioned it in the very first modular podcast that was the thing we were almost excited about from NAMM at the start of the year.
Yeah, it was.
I think the three of us that don't have one now have got to go and buy one before this podcast goes live, because they'll be sold.
Yeah. Really out of stock.
Thank you, guys. Yeah. It's cool to hear that from you guys, for sure, considering I'm still very new to this whole thing on, like, the design side. It's cool to hear people like what I'm working on idea-wise.
It's just very playable, you know. Brings it, like I said, I don't want to keep banging on about it, but it was one of those. And I think people have just to sort of sign off on it. When you've got a bigger system, you're not always as blown away by stuff as much. Whereas I remember when I got into it, everything that just had a different sound, I was like, wow, this is amazing. And then that almost wears off. Not because the gear's bad, just because you've got other good gear and you sort of, it raises the bar of what you may be expecting once you start to get more sort of good quality stuff. But that really was, as a few things do regularly, but that really was a, wow, this is cool. So check out patch examples for everyone listening. Cheers to Eric for your patch idea. I'm going to try that one out, which was the filter in the modulation path for FM or AM. That sounds like fun. Any questions, hit us up below. We'll get back to you. Anyone you'd like to see interviewed or featured on the next show, a topic for a next show, feel free to comment and we'll consider getting a show together for it. Last words from anyone or just bye?
Just thank you. That was a lot of fun.
Yeah, thanks for that. Corey, really loved it.
Yeah, it was really good.
Same to you, Tyler. Thanks for your time.
Yeah, worries. Thanks.
Say hi to Phil. Yeah, cheers for coming on. And I'm sure we'll speak to everyone soon. Cheers, guys. See you later.
Yeah. Cheers.